Okay, good morning to everybody. Today we are starting and of course finishing lecture number 11. Lecture number 11, as you can see here, is related to a very important part of the remote sensing course that is related to the image processing. And in this particular lecture, as you can see from the title, we go in depth in the radiometric image processing, while in the next lecture we will go through the geometric image processing. So now we are talking only about the radiometric image processing. All right, let's start with the remotely sensed image statistics. The representation of data, it is recorded on digital support, may not be satisfactory for the analyst and the interpreter. Usually, the values actually presented in the acquired images are distributed over a much more limited range than the possible gray level or blind levels of the display device. For example, if the radiance value of the scene observed in a certain spectral band are very similar to each other, the image will appear rather uniform and with low contrast. If the radiance values are all quite high, the image will tend to appear very bright and saturate the monitor. And you know, this is very important, and we already get these particular just talking about the geometric resolution, especially when we introduce the concept of contrast. In order to overcome these problems, it is necessary to approach tools of the univariate and multivariate statistical analysis. In fact, the measurements associated with the observations distributed in the geographical space and therefore linked to the spatial coordinates, whether obtained with active or passive techniques, in most cases constitute a multidimensional set variable according to the number of wavelengths or spectral bands used in the acquisition phase. This set of measurements, resulting in the digital image, is generally made up of thousands of millions of cells, so the number of observations is always very large. So what is important here is that we can use statistical methods, thanks to the fact that our images constitute a very high population of radiometric values of digital number. Because, for example, during the labs, you see, we are approaching images that are more or less 8,000 by 8,000. So that means that we have more than 60 million digital numbers. So that means that we have a rather huge population of data. And so out of from this data, we can, of course, use all the classical univariate or multivariate statistics methods. All right. Here, some basic notions of statistics, such as the probability distribution, expected value, normal distribution. A random variable assigns a unique numerical value to each possible observation. The random variable is indicated with x, while xi indicates the value assumed at the ith observation. The random variable can be of the continuous type if it can assume infinite values in a certain range, such as the weights obtained from a series of measurements, or of the discrete type if it can only take a limited number of values in a certain range, such as the head or cross number in the toss of a coin, or in our case, the digital number associated with a cell. So that means that we need to think about that our images, and in particular the digital number, could be related to a random variable, because the way in which the radiance is recorded by the detector of the sensor mounted on board of the satellite platform is the way in which is recorded a radiance that has the behavior of a random variable. So we can use the concept of a random variable and the distribution of a typical random variable in order to see how the digital number could range in our images. So that means that the probability distribution Px of a random variable x specifies the probability that the random variable x takes the value xi, that is, it is the p, the probability that this function here, the x that is equal to xi. So, if we want to check which is the behavior of a random variable, but you, of course, you already know that, the typical bell shape of the normal or Gaussian distribution function and the underlying areas. And now we are seeing the example of a Gaussian distribution A, that has this particular, look at the mouse, this is the function is this one, and you see this is the distribution of a Gaussian variable that is typical of a random variable as our digital number. So this distribution has a very important characteristics, and we have some way from the statistical point of view to measure the distribution. That means that we have a mean value mu and a different variance sigma, and this is the Gaussian distribution. And you see here we have some other different distribution, and now I will explain that. So this is the shape of the distribution, and you see that in the maximum of the distribution we have the mean value. But let's check to explain the characteristics of this distribution. Because a normal distribution is completely defined through the two parameters, mean value mu and variance sigma. It also has the following characteristics that is very typical to a Gaussian distribution. The first one, it is symmetrical around the mean value. The mean value, the mode, and the median of the distribution coincide. The area under the curve is unitary. Then the surface between the two ordinates with a sigma inflection point of the curve from mu includes the 68% of the total of the values. For 2 sigma from mu, the area is 95%, and for 3 sigma, it is 99.7%. This is equivalent to saying that the 68% of the elements have an x value comprised between the mean value and the variance. So this is very typical of this function. And finally, the central limit theorem states that the sum of a large number of the identically distributed and independent random variables roughly follows a number follows a normal distribution. So that means that if we have the sum of a large number of random variables, the results of this sum will be again a normal distribution. Let's go back just to see our distribution. You see that here, from the mean value and the variance, you see, we have the 68% of the values. So while here, you see, in 2 sigma from mu to 2 sigma and minus 2 sigma, we have the 95% of the distribution. And in the toes of the distribution, that represents, of course, a very small part of the elements, in this case only the 5%, if we take the 3 sigma range from the mu, we have almost all the distribution. So that means that this is the typical distribution that we could face when analyzing, and we saw that during the labs, the statistical distribution of the digital numbers of our different spectral bands. So let's go to the image histograms. So now we are just taking into consideration our example, our image example. So one of the simplest, but at the same time most useful tools in the digital image processing, as we saw in the different labs, it is the frequency histogram. It is the first step required for image exploration. The histogram of the representation of the statistical distribution function of a particular dataset. In the graph, of the histogram function of a digital image, the index numbers, digital number, appears on the abscess, of course, on the x-axis, and if we have an 8-bit distribution, usually we have a range from 0, as we know, to 255, and on the ordinate, the frequency f, absolute or relative, that means that the number of cells of the image matrix that have the same digital number value. And we will see, of course, the figure. If we assume that the measurement associated with the cells, for example, the digital numbers, constitute a series of observations of independent random variables, now we can state, and this is written in bold because it is very important here, it is possible to interpret each function value as the probability of finding a cell in the image with that gray level X. So the histogram, therefore, represents an approximation of the probability of occurrence of the gray levels, that is an approximation of the PDF probability density function, in which PDF is the acronym of probability density function, of course. So the histogram, therefore, characterizes an image from the statistical point of view, but does not provide any information about the spatial arrangement of the digital number values in the image itself. You remember during the labs, we have an histogram, so we know how the digital number are distributed in the image, but we don't know where a certain frequency value of the digital number is located on the image. So where the histogram is not giving us any information about the spatial arrangement of the cells that have that particular digital numbers. So while a single histogram corresponds to an image, a given histogram can correspond to several images completely different from each other. And this is quite clear, and we will see an example of that, of that things here. So these are the histograms, and you see it's still in Italian, but you see on the left part of this image, we have of this figure, we have an image, a remote sense image, and you see here we have the classical histogram, where on the X we have the digital numbers, and on the y-axis we have the frequency of particular digital numbers, and you see here this is an example of a unimodal histogram where we have a peak, and you see we have it's quite similar to really quite similar, it's of course not a normal distribution, but you see here there's some similarity to a normal distribution. That means in this case that the digital number of this image is something that could be represented in some way with a Gaussian or with a random variable. Here in the image below, you see here we have a lake and we have a river. That means that a large part of the image is covered by water. For example, I assume that this is an infrared band, so you see the water is very dark, while here it's maybe there's vegetation, so it's quite reflective in the infrared. So that means that you see here we have two peaks of the distribution, so that means that this is a bimodal histogram. I mean, the very low maximum here, low digital number value, is related to the water. So, I mean, in this area of the histogram, we have all the water, while here, with larger values of the digital number, we have, for example, all the other part of the image. So that means that we have a bimodal histogram. And we will see, and we already analyzed that in the labs. When we have an unimodal distribution, we can, for example, convert in an analytical way this histogram in another histogram with a different shapes. While when we have a bimodal histogram, I mean, that operation is not possible on the whole histogram, but only using part of this histogram. All right, and these are the explanation of what I just said. And so, just taking into consideration what I said before, that each image corresponds to a single histogram. I'm sorry, but given an histogram, different images can correspond to it, in which the spatial arrangement of the cell changes with the same digital number of gray levels. This is a very bad figure. You see, we have three matrix here, where you see in the left one, for example, we have three darker cells and six brighter cells. In the middle, in the figure in the center, we have are more or less the same, but also this cell here should be darker, and this is not in the figure. And here we have the three darker cells in other positions. So you see, these three images are definitely different from each other, but they have, of course, the same histogram, because I mean, three cells are dark and six cells are brighter. So I mean, you see here, this is the classical explanation where the same histogram could be attained to different images, of course. So this is a very simple explanation of that. So you remember during the labs, we had also introduced the scatter plots, and in a similar way to the histogram, it is possible to define the scatter plot of a multispectral image as the function that associates the frequencies in the two radiance bands with each cell. So you remember, we have, for example, here again in Italian, we have here for the same image two different bands. This is a thematic mapper acquisition. In the upper part, we have band 3, that is the red, and in the lower one, we have band 5, that is a mid-infrared. So you remember the scatter plots, it's a very simple diagram where in the x and in the y-axis we have both digital numbers, and these digital numbers, for example, in this case, in the x-axis we have the digital number that are coming from the mid-infrared band, the band 5, and here in the y-axis we have the digital number that are coming from band 3, that is the red band in the thematic mapper. And so you see here we have a point clouds that are all the single points, the single cells of the matrix. So here the point clouds, as you already know, is the number of the total cell of every single image, and of course these two images have the same number of cells, of course, because they are overlapping. So this point clouds is made by all the cells of the image, and of course you can represent simply a single cell of the image in the two bands by a couple of coordinates in this diagram of digital numbers. So that means that you can represent that in a clouds. And you see here that having these clouds in this configuration, that means and we will see that from the theoretical point of view, that's a sort of correlation. Because I mean, for lower value of the band 5, we have also lower value for band 3 in this area here, for example. Look at the mouse. And what is in reality these things here in the image? Of course, it's the water, because it's a poor reflector, both in the infrared and in the red band. Well, here you see that for high value of the band 5, we have also high value for the band 3, and that maybe is vegetation, for example. And here we have all the other things that are represented in the image. So the scatter plot, as we know from the labs, can give useful information concerning bands correlation. And so, for example, here you see we have this representation that should be read in column. I'm sorry, it's still in Italian. Well, in the left column from in this scatter plot here, in this one, we have a very high correlation of the bands. In the center column with these two diagrams, we have a moderate correlation, while in the left, in the right part of the column, in these two the histograms here, we have no correlation at all. What does it mean? That as I mentioned before, this is an example of very high correlation. You remember we saw that in the hyperspectral images, where two bands, especially with a very close range of wavelengths, is strictly correlated to each other. That means that I can use whatever bands in order to represent the same phenomena, because I mean the two bands are more or less similar from the statistical point of view, and this correlation you see is positive, while in theory we can also have this negative correlation. That means that for lower values of a single bands here in the y-axis, we have higher values of the other correlated bands, and vice versa. But we mentioned during the labs that usually we have a very typical correlation, for example, between the visible bands and the mid-infrared bands. And when we have this correlation, it's hardly to explain that. It's almost impossible from the theoretical point of view. But when we have correlation, the correlation is always positive, you remember, and never negative. Here is an example. Is missing here in this part here, but we have the moderate correlation in a negative way. You see that the point clouds is larger, and this is a very typical example of when we are having, for example, the scatter plots of, for example, band 3 or the red band and the near infrared band, where we have something that is not really correlated, but as we saw during the labs, we can have different area of the scatter plot where we can find, for example, the different surfaces, vegetation or water into the image. While here you see there's no correlation, because for whatever values of one band, you can have whatever values of the other. And this is typically, and we saw that again, when we are correlating, for example, whatever band that is recording reflectance and a band that is recording emission. So from the theoretical point of view, you remember the radiation laws, there's of course a correlation from the theoretical point of view between the emission coefficient and the reflection coefficient, you remember, with the Kirchhoff's law. But I mean, in the real case, not acquiring images in a thermal equilibrium, I mean, there's no correlation at all. So I mean, when we are taking into consideration a single cell, this single cell could be very reflective in a particular band and very emissive in another, or on the contrary, should could be very absorptive for the reflectance point of view, and could emit a very big quantity of energy. So it means there's no correlation, and that could be easily get from the scatter plot point clouds shape. Okay, let's go to the point transformation. And talking about point transformation, let's say that it constitutes a simple but important class of image processing techniques. These point transformations allow the user to modify the radiometry or the gray DN value associated with the cell, so that the new gray DN digital number value depends solely on the cell value, unlike the spatial transformations, in which, as we will see, the new digital number value associated with the cell depends on the values of the neighboring cells. So, what is very important here is that the point transformations cannot modify the spatial relationships inside the image, but they intervene only on the radiometry of the image, and therefore they are also called radiometric transformations. They are available in all image processing systems, and their main characteristics are interactively adaptability, user-friendliness, and efficiency. So they are very simple and they are very efficient, as we saw during the labs. Not being based on a physical model, but being of an empirical type, most of these techniques require a rather good operator experience, as we saw, to provide useful results. Let me check if we are registering, recording everything, in order just to be sure. So here it is, we are half an hour more or less. All right, let's go on. So, I mean, using this point transformation, you see, for example, changing the histogram, of course, is something that is doing by in an empirical modes, and of course, it's a rather good operator experience is required when using this kind of processing tools. Okay, let's talk about the contrast enhancing. And so the human eye, as we know, is able to distinguish a limited number of gray levels that usually are ranging between 20 and 30 when we are looking at images in, of course, in a panchromatic mode, so in gray levels. So if they are adjacent and well separated, of course, we can distinguish this range of gray levels. Otherwise, we are not in the good condition. Therefore, the improvement of the contrast makes it easier for the human eye to appreciate the subtle gray variation of the image. I made this example with gray tones because it's simpler to catch in comparison with colors. So, I mean, if we are enlarging the contrast, enhancing the contrast of the image, of course, we can also, with our eyes, with the limitation of our vision with respect to the gray levels, if we are enhancing the contrast, of course, we will get more subtle differences between adjacent gray levels. It often happens that the digital image has a distribution of digital number levels that is characterized by the fact that the most part of the cells are within a narrow range of values, resulting in a very poor image contrast. And we saw that it is the classical behavior that we can find in our remotely sensed image. And this is due to the fact that remote sensing systems, in particular those on board satellites that have global coverage, observe and measure radiance values from surfaces, for example snow, forest, cities, seas, deserts, during each orbit with responses usually different from each other. The sensors, then, are designed in such a way as to be able, as much as possible, to provide significant measurements on all types of surfaces observed, possibly avoiding saturation effects on the recorded radiant signals. So, in general, the dynamic range of the radiant signal cannot be changed during the acquisition phase, but in the data representation process, is then possible to intervene on the dynamic range of the signal. This type of processing, which tends to change the contrast of the image, is generally called contrast stretching. So that means that talking about the dynamic range is of course the possible range of radiance that are coming from the investigated surface. And I mean, on both of the satellites, our sensors should grant the possibility to acquire a very large dynamic range of the signal that is coming from the Earth's surface. That means that being calibrated for this higher dynamic range is happening that I mean the images are acquired in a condition where we check that during the labs on the image that I mean the dynamic range of the actual observation in a single scene is limited, of course, to the illumination condition. So is depending, of course, on the energy that is coming from the sun on this scene. And of course, if we are acquiring a scene where we have a uniformity of surfaces, for example, more or less the same scene, for example, think about a surface of water, and we are acquiring the middle of the sea, of course, I mean, all the radiance that is coming to the sensor is limited in a very small dynamic range, because the water in the same spectral band is behaving, is reflecting in a very similar way. So that means that image will be acquired, the radiant signal will be sampled in a very narrow range of digital numbers. That means that the image will be the effect to have a very small contrast. And so the possibility, of course, we cannot change the dynamic range acquisition on board of the sensor, but because I mean this is very difficult to perform, because it's a sort we need to intervene with the calibration of the sensor, the radiometric calibration of the sensor, so it's very tricky and it's not very intelligent. It's not very a very intelligent operation, because we can do that afterwards with our data without intervening on the sensor itself. And all these operations are, for example, in this case, in the field of contrast stretching. So the algorithm consists of a function that transforms the radiometry of the image, allowing the range of gray levels recorded in the original image to be expanded in order to cover the entire possible dynamic range of the display device. So, for example, if we are talking about linear contrast stretching, this procedure linearly expands the range of radiometric values X present in the image, so has to bring the minimum and maximum values to coincide with the minimum and maximum value of intensity of gray level scale of the display device. The transformation function, that is called here GX, is given by the following equation. Very simple. It's a linear representation where we have these two coefficients, a and b, and these two coefficients are representing the angular coefficient, a, of the straight line, and they can also be interpreted as the gain factor between the input signal x and this transformating value y. And if the gain value is it's bigger than one, then there is an expansion of the original range, while if A is less than one, then there is a compression. So this is the representation of that. So you see here it's very simple. We have, for example, this diagram, and we saw that during the labs. Here we have, for example, the original data in the x-axis. So the data value are red on the image, and in the y-axis we have our digital number has displayed on the screen. So taking into consideration our software, this is the data value on the x-axis, and this is the screen value as represented on the screen. So you see that the angular coefficient a of this function, it's as is red in the image, you see, it's represented in a very small ranges of value in the display output. So I mean, if we are changing the inclination of that, you see, with a more than one, so it's a equal to one is of course the line that is dividing in two parts this diagram. If it's more than one, of course, and we are changing this inclination, of course, we are representing a smaller value of read value of data value into a larger screen value. That means that on the screen, we are improving the contrast, just moving and changing the angle from here to here. Why? If we are depressing the angle, so we are taking A less than one, of course, we are changing the contrast in the way that the image, the displayed image, is even less contrasted than the original one. All right. So, the most typical formulation of the linear transformation GX is given for the DN index number of each cell by the following relationship. So, you see here that the digital number 1, with this one here, that is the displayed values, is equal to this expression here. And what is this expression? Of course, digital number 1 are the index numbers of gray levels of the transformed image. K0 and K1 are the minimum and maximum index number of the original image, for example, the extremes of the histogram, while 255 is the range of gray levels that can be displayed on the screen. And so you see that, I mean, this ratio here, 255 and 55 divided by K1 minus K2, is representing in our linear function the inclination, the A factor that we saw before, what is called gain, you remember, and these things here is representing what we are called offset. So I mean the difference between the displayed values in comparison with the differences between the actual digital values read on the image and the minimum we decided to represent. So I mean this is an example, a numerical one, that is representing a linear contrast stretching. So you see here And this is the explanation. You see, this is the image that we had before, the bimodal distribution. You see, this is the original image, and this is the original histogram, you remember, before here. And when we are using this linear contrast stretching, as we've done during the labs, the result is this one. So you see, what is very dark is continue to remain in the same position in the histogram, for example, here the water, while we are expanding, we are stretching the histogram over the representation, the display of the screen, the displayed values. We are stretching that, and you see that we have a higher separation between low value and higher value. You see this part here. Is expanded here, so that means that this histogram, that is the modified histogram with the linear contrast stretching, has a result, as you can see here, give an image that is of course brighter than this one, but of course is more contrasted because we have much difference between, for example, these vegetated areas and this water. More than in the original image. So, I mean, our eyes could catch easily the differences between adjacent digital gray levels of the image. So, we already saw in the very first labs that we have from the point transformation another possibility that is related to the density slicing. And with the density slicing, I'm sorry, the continuous scale of gray tones that I mean generally are comprised between 0 and 255 of a monospectral image or a panchromatic one of a gray tones one is divided into a certain number of intervals, and the digital number index corresponding to each interval are grouped into a single level of gray, which is assigned a new index number, digital number output. The density slicing techniques, so, can be considered as a particular contrast modification method. I'm sorry, the choice of the extremes of the intervals and the relative new gray values is decided by the user who determines them accordingly to the objectives to be obtained during the visualization phase, and generally on the basis of the information obtained from the statistical analysis of the data. So the density slicing technique results, as we know, in a pseudo color image. In fact, since the color code is arbitrary and represents a certain range of digital numbers, and therefore a certain range of intensity of radiance, the colors do not have a direct relationship with the original colors of the scene, of course, intended as a RGB system, but they result as a synthetic single band color image where the maximum number of colors corresponds to the radiometric resolution. And here we have a very simple image that is clearly represent the concept of the histogram slicing. You see here, look at the mouse, we have the histogram of the image that we are not representing because we are taking into consideration only the statistical characteristics. So here we have the digital number on the x-axis, on the y we have the frequency, and this is the histograms. And you see the density slicing is the way in which we can divide the data value into ranges, and we are assigning to every single range you see here a particular color. So, for example, you see from digital number 4 to digital number 5, we are assigning, for example, this violet, and for example, from 30 to 31, the yellow that is here. Of course, which will be the color most assigned? Will be the color that is, for example, ranging from this light blue to the green, because you see we have the peak, we have the maximum of the histogram, so of course there will be more cells here. So you see here that ranging from 15 to 19, we have the maximum of the distribution. So I don't know which is the image that is represented by this histogram, but I'm sure that with a pseudo color image, with the density slicing techniques, the most represented colors will be this very light green, of course, because it's the maximum of the distribution, of course. So how we can represent that? We can represent that with this lookup table. So each of the contrast modification techniques described above is normally carried out not by means of a direct transformation of the digital number associated with the cells of the original image, but through the use of a transformation table that is called LUT, LUT, that stands for lookup table. From a logical point of view, a lookup table is a vector of n elements, where n corresponds to the radiometric resolution. So for example, for 8-bit resolution, we will have 256 elements, that is the total number of these n elements, that convert the input data into new outputs, values, according to a certain transformation function. The digital number index number of the input cell defines the position or address of the vector element, and at the output there is the index number, that is the digital number output, let's say, contained in that position of the vector. For example, and this is displayed in the following figure, different digital number values are converted into different colors. So you see, we have this lookup table that, from the pictoric point of view, could be represented in these things here. So we have the column where we are representing all the n elements, the digital number that I can find in that particular image. Consider that the lookup table could be applied to every single spectral bands of our acquisition. So here, for example, I can have eight different values, and of course, in our case, if we are using an 8-bit radiometric resolution acquisition, I will have 256 value ranging from 0 to 255. And from this pictorial representation of the lookup table to the number 0, for example, I'm associating the red colors. And if this is the image, the representation will be this one. So, for example, you see that I have here the 0 values in this cell, and I mean, when represented, when displayed on the screen, this cell here will be represented in blue, while here, in this cell here where I have 5, is represented in cyan. And of course, why in cyan? Because in the color lookup table, number 5 is reported to that should be represented in cyan. This is the pictorial representation of the lookup table. How I can analytically describe these things here? Because I mean, I can represent this lookup table having, you see here, the same values as before, from 0 to 7, but instead of having colors, how we can synthesize a color with the three different components, of course, of RGB. So that means, let's go back, if the 0, 1 is a red and the 5 is a cyan, what I will have here, then in the 0 here, if it's red, the exact mixing of RGB quantities will be 255, 0 and 0. So here, as you remember during the labs, when we are using in the software the density slice menu, when we are changing and editing the colors, the number 0 will be represented with a saturated red, where if I have the number 5 that is represented with a cyan, that you remember is the complementary color of red, the cyan here in the lookup table in correspondence with the number 5 will be represented by a triplet in RGB that will be 0, 255, 255 for green and blue, and 0 of course for the red, and that will be represented in cyan. So this is the meaning of the lookup table. That is of course compulsory in order to display or to have pseudo color images, and you will see that we will have pseudo color images not only just having as we saw in the labs the density slicing procedures or for example the scatter plot output when we are coloring the images, but also for example when we are classifying images, the results is of course a pseudo color image. So now we have finished in a very simple way to talk about point transformation, and now we are changing slightly the topics because in the introduction we mentioned the facts that the punctual transformation, the point transformation, are related to the possibility to change a single digital number without taking into consideration what is happening in the neighboring cells. Now we are starting with introducing the local transformation that are related to the possibility to change a single digital number, taking in this case into consideration what is happening in the neighboring cell. So there is another class of image processing techniques, I'm sorry, that serve to highlight geometric information on or details present in the images, for example, the spatial characteristics. These processing techniques can take place either in the frequency domain, and in this case require the use of the Fourier transformation, or are applied directly to the image. The latter, in particular, are also indicated by the name of local transformations, since, unlike the point transformation techniques, as I mentioned before, in which, as previously seen, the value obtained at the output of the transformation is only a function of the value of the single cell, here, and this is very important and this is in bold, the results of their application depends on the values of the cells belonging to a neighborhood of the considered cell. It is the information of the context in which a certain cell is inserted, the spatial interdependence between the values of the cells, which is responsible for their variations that are perceived as spatial information or geometric details of the image. In analogy with what happens for a signal in one dimension, it is then possible to introduce the concept of spatial frequency also for an image, considered as a two-dimensional function. For example, Jensen in 1986 defines as the spatial frequency of an image the number of changes in the numeric values of the digital number of the cells per unit of distance for each part of the image. So I mean here the introduction of these things here that is very interesting, and you will see give the possibility to have a very powerful image transformation, and you all were amazed when applying digital filtering During the labs, you were very amazed, as me, about the results we can get. So, in order to fully understand the things here, we need to think about a different way of approaching the problems, just thinking about the spatial frequency of an image. So, the spatial frequency, I'm sorry, therefore indicates the rhythm of variation of the gray levels of an image. Slow variations of the numerical values of the pixels of the image correspond to low frequencies. Sudden variations of these values correspond to high frequencies. Where an image for which the numerical values of the pixels is constant corresponds to zero spatial frequency, of course. So this is a representation. I'm sorry, it's in Italian, but you see here if we have a sort of representation, a diagram, where in the X we have the time in which we are measuring the intensity of the signal. When we have this very constant value, here is a straight line, the results in the image is, I'm sorry, is represented by an image with a special frequency, that a null spatial frequency. That means, for example, if we are taking into consideration, for example, a radiometric profile, where here, instead of time, we have a measurements of a distance. For example, we are, as done during the labs, we are measuring the variation of the digital number along a straight line. I mean, if I don't have any variation, and here in the Y I have, for example, a digital number, the results is an image without any contrast. You see, if I have a very slow variation with a very slow frequency here, that means that I will have a low frequency that corresponds to an image with a very low contrast. Well, if I have here a very heavy variation, a very high frequency here, where in neighboring cell the variation of the digital number is very high, like in this image, you see, where I'm passing through adjacent cells that are very bright or very dark. I mean, of course, here I have a very high frequency of the variation of the digital number. That means that the resulting image will be very contrasted, of course, as we saw in the labs. All right, so concerning this local transformation, even images like signals can therefore be considered as formed by a set of many frequency components. So that means that we can have low frequencies that we can call LF, that stands of course for low frequency, to which the information related to most homogeneous surfaces or with variations of slow intensity are mainly linked. We can have high frequencies, HF, to which the information related to discontinuity between surfaces with different characteristics. So I mean the facts that we can have in adjacent cells a very high difference in the digital number sampled by the sensor. That means of course a very different radiance coming from the two adjacent surfaces, and the global information contained in an image results from the combination of these two types of information, that of the slow intensity variation from point to point in the image, so the low frequency component of the image, and that of the rapid variation, so the high frequencies. So that means that if we are representing with capital I, that is function of the, look at the mouse here, of this expression, that is a function of x and y, so that means that is representing every single cell, and this is our image function, as we saw in a previous lecture, we can intend this image as to be equal to the sum of the low frequency component and the high frequency component. So we can represent our image with the composition, with the algebraical sum of the low frequency component and the high frequency component. So if this is true, and we know that this is true because we saw that in the labs, by just checking that in the original images, so we can use these digital filters. So the purpose of these techniques is to obtain a noise reduction or a smoothing effect, or to produce an exaltation of details, this is the so-called sharpening, and the highlighting of spatial details such as linear elements or contours. You remember during the labs. The filtering in the space domain is achieved through the use of particular mathematical operators that are called convolution operators. Remember that convolution is the mathematical model that allows a description of the physical process of acquiring measurements by an instrument such as a sensor. So consider a signal over time represented by this function x, a function of t, that is the time. If it is input to a system, a modified y function of the time signal is found as the output. The system can consist of an electronic device, such as an amplifier or a filter, designed to modify the signal in a predetermined, intentional way. Or the system could be represented by an unwanted modification of the signal, due, for example, to a distortion or a noise effect. In general, the properties of the system can be described by a time function, that is h, a function of time of t, which is called the pulse system function, PSF, or also the system modulation transfer function that we already saw when talking about geometric resolution, what we called MTF. So both the original image L and the transformed image R are function of the spatial coordinates x and y in a continuous space. So we have these things here, that if we are multiplying, this is the productory factor of these two images, we can represent in a continuous spectrum the facts that we can multiply the in order to get the transform image, we can multiply the original image L for this image G, that and we will see in the next minutes what the G is. If we are multiplying in our space the original image with another artificial image, that is the convolution nucleus we will see in few moments, we can obtain the transformed image. Taking into consideration that this is typically the G matrix, what is called the convolutional operator, considering that when we are operating on digital images, we are facing discrete convolution, so we are working with discrete data set that is typically the representation of our digital image, we can represent the continuous domain in the discrete case, in which you see here we are trasforming the integrals in this way in order to consider, for example, the facts that the original image is in K and M, that are the index for column and lines, is multiplied in the productory form in a discrete case by this convolutional submatrix that is taking into consideration, you see, with that index, the cells that are around the cell that we need to transform of the original image in order to have the transformed image. Although the operator is defined for all the values of K and M, that are the index, the column and row index, it is effective only on a particular neighborhood of the cell coordinates EJ, where the G function is different from zero. I mean, of course, this G function could not be zero, otherwise the results would be zero again. This corresponds to a convolution call. And now we can introduce the G function as what we are calling the kernel, the convolution core, or filter core. The convolution core is therefore represented, the G function, by a numerical matrix characterized by two elements, its size and values, which determine its effectiveness. So you see, the convolutional operator operates on a digital image through the floating window techniques that is representing in the following figures. So you see, I'm sorry, it's in Italian, but in the look at the mouse, we have the 3D representation. So I mean, this is the original image, the L image, and this is the G image that you see is a submatrix. And for example, if we want, we need to transform this cell in a local convolution. I mean, we introduce the fact that this cell will be the new value calculated here, and this is the results, the R matrix. I mean, it's not depending like in a point transformation by the single cell, but is depending on the neighborhood cell here that are represented by this convolution nucleus, all right, by the G matrix. So I mean, we can perform some operation between these original cells, these nine cells here, and these nucleus of convolution in order to recalculate the center values that we take into account. And calculating that, we are writing a new matrix where we are rewriting the new values of the center cells of this convolution nucleus. And this is based, this operation, on what is called the floating window. So you see, this is the floating windows that in Italian is translated with finestra mobile. So this is the first calculation in the upper left position of the image. Then this convolution nucleus is shifting of one column, is calculating the new value, and the new values is attributed to the dark cell in the R output image, transformed image. So the floating windows is moving by columns, and then after finished the first cell, the first line is moving to another position here, third position, is floating over the second rows and is calculating the values of the new transformed image. And so, lines by lines, is able to calculate in a convolutional methods all the new values in the transformed R image. So, considering for simplicity a nucleus of dimension 3x3, the output digital number values of the cell of coordinates I and J, which is obtained at the output of the convolution operation, is given by the weighted sum of the cell belonging to the neighborhood according to the following algorithm. So you see here I can use these values in order to multiply the original image in this position with the kernel, that in this case it is called H, in order to have the processed image. So, where the digital number E and J are the intensity values of the cells or pixel at the coordinates, of course, E and J, of the image before and after the transformation. So, H, K and M are these coefficients of the convolution nucleus, and H is the sum of the co-coefficient, or is set equal to 1 when the sum of the coefficient is 0. Oh, okay, this term H is used to keep the new calculated values in approximately the same range as the cell values of the original image. So the final results in a new image having the same dimensions as the original image, excluding the edges. As it is not possible to superimpose a core completely on the cells located on the edges of the image, the edges of the image or the images are not defined. To remedy this situation, sometimes an artifice is used to consist in replicating mirror their values along the external frames of the image in order to allow the overlapping of the convolution nucleus also for this border pixel. What does it mean that I'm going back, you see here, when we are using this convolution nucleus, of course, in this case, having this convolution nucleus, and we saw that during the labs, of 3x3, of course, the first and the last line of the original image, of course, is not filtered, such as the first and the last column of the image. So in a 3x3 kernel, of course, I'm not filtering the first and the last lines and columns. And all we can simply, as in Envy, not filtering these columns, or I can use some other artifice, for example, to duplicate the value or to do something else. All right, so let's check some filters. So the most used filters in the image processing are mainly of two basic types: what is called high pass filters and low pass filter. The following figure shows the differentiated effect of the two types of filters of an image and its histogram. The action produced by a low pass filter, and we are calling the low pass filter LPF, is to decrease the spatial frequency of the image, while the effect produced by an high pass filter HPF is to increase the frequency space. So these are the example. This is a very classical example. So you see here in the left part we have the original image, that is this guy here that is filming with his camera. In the middle we have the results of a low pass filters. So here we are getting the low frequency of the image, while here in the right part of the right image we have used an high pass filter, and we extract the high frequency of the image that you see here are typically the radiometric borders of the image. So you see here we can easily catch that is a camera, that is a tripod, and also in the back we have some buildings. While of course, in the low pass filtering, we are only catching all the uniform areas, such as the coats of this guy here. All right. If we are talking about a low pass filter, the simplest method to implementing it is to apply one of the following convolution core, respectively 3x3 or 5x5 to the image, so this one. So what does it mean that that things here, as we saw in the labs, if we are using this kernel here, what does it mean, these things here? That I will multiply all the single digital values by one here, I will sum all the values, and I will divide the sum of all the 9 numbered cells by the total number, that in this case is 9, and in this case is 25. So I'm taking these local values of digital number that having as weight 1 is the same things of multiplying the digital original number, the digital number original in the image by 1, so is the same of taking these 9 original digital number of the neighboring cells, dividing that by the total number of cells, 9 in this case, that is the equivalent of calculating the mean values. So this is corresponding, as is written here, to calculate the arithmetic mean of the values of the cells, and that means that is just using the floating windows to calculate the mean values of the cells, in which of course when this kernel is moving, for example in the second column, of course what we are get are the original images, not the calculated one. So when we have calculated these first values, that is the barycentric position of the kernel, I mean in the second calculation, when the kernel is shift of one columns, we are not taking into account the calculated values, of course, but we are taking into account the original values. That's why it is difficult to explain, but if we are taking into consideration the calculated values, I mean there's an effect that from the statistical point of view is related to the variance propagation, and this is not the case. So we are not taking into consideration the calculated the values, but always the original ones. So we can calculate the average value in a local neighboring values of the cells, and this is the way in which we can calculate, for example, the low-pass filter, while the HPF, the high-pass filtering, has the purpose of highlighting the edges or contours between groups of homogeneous cells and to enhance the areas of transition between different values in the image. The high-pass filter can be operated by applying a convolution core characterized by a positive coefficient for the central element and negative coefficient for the other elements, such as these following examples. So for example, again here, you see, we can multiply every single digital image of this small window of the kernel by a negative value. So that means that we are taking into account the negative value of the original image, and I can sum all these values with the center values multiplied by 8 and to divide everything by 9. I will have the values of these things here. So in order to proceed, I'm sorry. Okay, so that means that if we have differences between the center cell and the neighbor cell, that means that the contrast will be enhanced. If this area is very smooth from the contrast point of view, so I mean all the digital numbers are very similar to each other, that I will have the same values. So the image resulting from the application of an high-pass filter appears as more sharp, and the local details information appears more evident. Furthermore, the histograms of the images present in the present the typical form of normal or Gaussian distribution curves. So you see here we have two different cases that are numerical cases. You can check that perfectly. For example, here the center values of the original image is 100 and the other are more or less 200. When I'm using, for example, this kernel, you see the results will be that the center values is turned into to be 9 and the other remain the same. So I mean, you see these values is more contrasted than before because the difference between the center values and the neighborhood in the original image was around 100 and here is around 200. In the second case, you see here the difference was 60, more or less 60, and now is 120. So you see, this is a negative and this is a positive border. This is a darker value inside a brighter area, and this is a bright point inside a darker area. But you see that using this filter, the result is this one. So it's very clear these things here. So another easy way to make an high pass filter is using this relation that we saw in an unbelievable way during the labs, that the high pass filter could be calculated subtracting to the original image the low pass one. And of course, we can also get the low pass filter as the subtraction between the original image and the high pass one. And so this is the representation, and here we have also the numerical representation in one single dimension of a kernel that is three cells. And you see here the A is the original, the radiometric profile of the original image. B is the radiometric profile of the low pass image, in this case only one single line, of course. The C is the A minus B, so the original image minus the low pass, that is of course the high pass, while D is the original image plus the high pass, that is the possibility to have this add back option, that is to add contrast to an image as we saw during the labs. So this is the effect represented in a very simple radiometric profile. We can also use a median pass filter because the difficulty of setting the right threshold value, say, suggests to take into consideration an alternative way, the median filter. In this type of filter, the coordinate cells I and j is replaced with the median of the values of the surrounding cell defined by the floating window. So the first line is the original image, the second one is the low pass filter, the third one you are not interested that in low pass filter with thresholds, and in the last one is the median filter. Why we are using the median filter is very important, as I explained to you during the labs, that when we are calculating a low pass with using the mean values, We are calculating the value and new values of the transformed image that could not belong to the original distribution of the values. While when we are calculating a median values, of course, the median values is belong to the original distribution of the digital number. So that means that calculating the median pass filter, we are not, I mean, inventing new values. We are not interpolating new values that are not representing real radiance coming from real surfaces, but we are using values that were already recorded on board on the sensor by the detectors. That means that are representing real surfaces. We can also have directional filters. I don't want to waste time in order to explain in depth these things, but of course, considering that we have the possibility to use different kernels, you see, these directional filters are all high pass filters family filters, of course, and you see that taking into consideration an high pass, if you are using this kernel here, look at the mouse, I have a high pass or a directional filter in the horizontal position. So in this case, as we tested during the labs, I can extract horizontal configuration, horizontal radiometric borders. Here I can extract vertical borders, radiometric borders, and here diagonal in the different direction, or in this configuration, or in this one. Okay? It's very simple, these things here. And so this is nothing that is in this lesson. So I mean, with these last things, the directional filters that we already tested during the labs, the lecture number one is concluded. We talked, we introduced all the issues related to the radiometric image processing. So I mean, let's check the recording. After 1 hour and a half, more or less, as usual, we are considering close this lecture number 11. Take care, everybody, and as usual, never give up.